Testing, testing, 1, 2, 3.
Testing, testing, testing. Hello, hello. Okay. Testing, testing, 1, 2, 3. Testing, testing. Yeah, it usually is. So you press 1 in. Yes, you have to go up. Now, how does that sound? Testing, testing, 1, 2. 1, 2.
Testing for the court reporter. Testing, testing. Testing for the court reporter. Coming. Testing for the court reporter. Testing. Testing for the court reporter.
But push that. Oh, it's in?
Okay.
No, I mean the button.
Testing for the court reporter, testing. Testing for the court reporter, testing.
All right, Jim, you ready?
Yeah.
Good afternoon. The subcommittee will come to order. Welcome to our hearing on plutonium disposition program and the MOX project. To our witnesses, thank you for being here. We know it takes a lot of time to prepare and get ready for these things, and I really appreciate your investment. Your contributions make a big difference to our ability to do our jobs. Our distinguished witnesses today are the Honorable Frank Klotz, Administrator, National Nuclear Security Administration, Mr. John McWilliams, Associate Deputy Secretary, U.S. Department of Energy, and Mr. Tom Mason, Director, Oak Ridge National Laboratory. This hearing is examining one of the Department of Energy's largest and highest profile construction projects. The MOX project and the broader plutonium disposition program have been the subject of several recent reviews. The leaders of two of those reviews are at the witness table today. Mr. McWilliams and Secretary Moniz's internal assessment team, and Dr. Mason led the independent red team. They both also been involved in figuring out what DOE should do about key uranium capabilities that are critical to our national security. Gentlemen, you seem to get all the easy issues. They're joined by General Klotz, who is no stranger to difficult challenges. General Klotz has overall responsibility for executing the program as head of the NNSA. And we look forward to hearing from all of you about the department's current status on this program as the committee looks to help the nation determine what is in the best interest of the taxpayer and our national security. With that, let me turn to our ranking member for any statement that he might like to make.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I ask unanimous consent that my opening statement be put into the record, and I would like to make some additional oral remarks. Thank you. Welcome the witnesses, and I'm glad we're having this oversight hearing. It's been a long time since this committee has had one. By some counts, almost 10 years. A lot has happened in that time. And I'm worried that as we enter the month of October and head toward Halloween, that really the subject of this hearing is a horror story for the American taxpayer, because we all want a good outcome. And yet this has been way more expensive and way slower than anybody really could have imagined 10, 15 years ago. I almost want to dedicate this hearing to a former colleague of ours, a Republican congressman named Dave Hobson, who spotted the trouble way back 10 or 15 years ago. He wanted to do something about it. He was unable to. And then he later reported in 07 he was politically pressured not to do anything about it. So there have been various people for a long time trying to do the right thing for the American taxpayer. I hope that we can do it today. Mr. Mason's testimony, I think, will make clear that whatever we decide, we need to decide something. We can't let the day of decision just keep on waiting. So I'm hopeful that we will read the studies, congratulate the Department of Energy and NSA for having followed Congress's mandate to do these studies and to report, you know, what we can expect unless we take a prompt decision. So I thank the witnesses. I look forward to your testimony.
Thank you. We'll now ask each of our witnesses to make an opening statement and summarize their opening statements in 5 minutes. Your written testimony will be accepted for the record. General Klotz, I understand you have one written statement for the Department of Energy, and Mr. McWilliams, no statement?
I do not, sir.
Okay. General Klotz, you're recognized for a verbal opening statement.
Thank you, Chairman Rogers, Ranking Member Cooper, other members of the subcommittee. It's an honor, as always, to appear before you on behalf of the Department of Energy and the National Nuclear Security Administration. Again, we thank you for your continued support for our nuclear security mission and for our people. We also appreciate the opportunity to discuss plutonium disposition and the mixed oxide or MOX fuel fabrication facility project with you today. And I appreciate the fact you will put our written statement into the record. Let me state at the outset that the department remains committed to the Plutonium Management and Disposition Agreement, or PMDA, between the United States and Russia, and will continue to support the mission to dispose of 34 metric tons of excess U.S. weapons-grade plutonium. At the same time, the department has been working to determine if there are opportunities to make the current MOX fuel approach for plutonium disposition more efficient, since it has become clear that this approach will be significantly more expensive than originally anticipated. There have been, as you noted, several efforts over the last 2 years to analyze the current MOX fuel approach and alternatives, including a 2014 internal Department of Energy review, the 2015 congressionally mandated independent assessments by the Aerospace Corporation, and most recently, a 2015 Red Team review tasked by the Secretary of Energy and conducted by a team of U.S. and U.K. experts led by Dr. Tom Mason, the director of Oak Ridge National Laboratory. Consistently, these analyses have concluded that the projected life cycle costs of the MOX fuel approach for plutonium disposition will be in the range of $30 to $50 billion, and possibly higher, and will require approximately $1 billion a year in escalated dollars for decades for construction and for the operational expenses for the life of the project. With the challenging and uncertain budget environment, and with a life cycle cost in excess of $30 billion, we believe there will be insufficient long-term funding available to support the MOX fuel approach and do all the other things which the administration and the Congress have called upon the Department of Energy and NNSA to do in its full portfolio of activities. Further, these analyses have all concluded that there is an alternative option that would be less than half the cost of the MOX fuel approach and have far lower risks, the so-called dilution and disposal approach. The fiscal year 2015 Appropriations and Authorization Acts directed that construction of the MOX project continue in fiscal year 2015 at a level of $345 million. The fiscal year 2016 continuing resolution, which funds the department through December 11, 2015, maintains the status quo for this project. As such, the department has been continuing construction of the MOX facility, despite the fact that, in our view, this funding level is too low to make any significant progress in completing the project. While these studies were underway throughout the last two calendar years, the department has been discussing with individual members of Congress and with staff the best path forward. We have also raised our ongoing analysis of plutonium disposition options with our Russian counterparts. The U.S.-Russian PMDA provides for disposition by irradiation or any other method as may be agreed by the two parties to the agreement. As we determine our path forward as a nation, we will continue these discussions with the Russians. So again, Mr. Chairman, thank you for the opportunity to be here, and I look forward to answering your questions and Mr. Cooper's questions, as well as the other members of the subcommittee.
Thank you, General. Mr. McWilliams, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman Rogers, Ranking Member Cooper, and members of the subcommittee. I appreciate the opportunity to appear before you today to discuss the Department of Energy's efforts to dispose of surplus weapon-grade plutonium, which is a topic of great importance to Secretary Moniz and to Deputy Secretary Sherwood Randall. I am, as was mentioned, the Department of Energy's Associate Deputy Secretary, and I also serve as the Secretary's Senior Finance Advisor. I have a private sector background and have focused most of my career on investment and financing in the energy sector since about the mid-1980s. I joined the department in June of 2013, and I've had the opportunity since then to work closely with Administrator Klotz on a variety of national security issues, including the plutonium disposition program. Shortly after I joined the department, the Secretary asked me to lead a new special working group that he established in June of 2013, focused on plutonium disposition. As part of our efforts to determine ways to improve the efficiency of the plutonium disposition mission, which, as General Klotz just mentioned, it remains a critical and very important mission, the working group undertook a detailed analysis of our disposition options. The Plutonium Disposition Working Group includes the Office of the Administrator, as well as the Offices of Defense Nuclear Nonproliferation, Nuclear Energy, Acquisition and Project Management, General Counsel, and Congressional and Intergovernmental Affairs. And the department issued a report with the working group's analysis of surplus weapon-grade plutonium disposition options in April of 2014. The analysis concluded that the projected life cycle costs of the MOX fuel approach for plutonium disposition would be approximately $30 billion. I think it's important at the outset to clarify that the MOX fuel approach life cycle cost includes much more than just the MOX fabrication facility, which is located in Savannah River. Rather, it's the entire disposition program, which starts with pit disassembly and conversion, then moves into the MOX fabrication facility. Wastes come out in the waste solidification building. We then have waste qualification and ultimately reactor modifications necessary to burn the fuel in light water reactors. The analysis also concluded that there is an alternative option that would be less than half the cost of the MOX fuel approach and have far fewer risks, and that is the dilution and disposal approach, which we will discuss today at length. Our efforts to re-examine the ways that we are implementing our plutonium disposition mission are part of a larger focus in the department on improving our performance of major projects across the enterprise. As you're well aware, we manage some of the most truly one-of-a-kind projects, very difficult projects, often handling radioactive conditions. And in light of these, we have struggled, and we've been on GAO's high-risk list since the inception of that list in the 1990s. To meet those challenges, the Secretary has instituted a number of changes to improve our performance on major projects, and he's made improving management performance at the Department of Energy a top priority, which has been recognized by GAO and others. In fact, in 2013, GAO narrowed its DOE focus to only the contracts and projects over $750 million in the department, the department's Office of Environmental Management and also in NSA. In addition, since the creation of NSA's Office of Acquisition and Project Management in 2011, they've delivered on an $800 million project portfolio, approximately $60 million or 7.5% below budget. In the last year, the Secretary has issued two significant decision memos. One of those created the Project Management Risk Committee, which I chair. So the reforms and processes that we're instituting at DOE with respect to project management are critical steps to ensuring we continue to be responsible stewards of taxpayers' dollars. We are encouraged by the work that we've done over the last 2 years, but we recognize that many challenges remain, including the plutonium disposition program. We look forward to working with Congress to ensure that the program is on the best path forward. Thank you, and I'll be pleased to answer your questions.
Thank you. And Dr. Mason, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Chairman Rogers, Ranking Member Cooper, and members of the committee, thank you for this opportunity to appear before you today. My name is Thomas Mason. I'm director of the U.S. Department of Energy's Oak Ridge National Laboratory. And as General Klotz has told you, Secretary Moniz tasked me with assembling and leading a red team to assess options for disposing of surplus weapons-grade plutonium. We were directed to consider the mixed oxide fuel, or MOX, approach that is the current baseline, an alternative entitled dilute and dispose, and any other alternatives that we viewed as meriting consideration. In particular, we're asked to evaluate the previous assessments of plutonium disposition options and reconcile cost differences among them, analyze ways that the MOX approach might be modified to reduce its cost, and examine risk assumptions and their impact on the cost. The Red Team reviewed a number of previous assessments of plutonium disposition options, and as part of the process, we interviewed several members of the teams that conducted these assessments. We heard topical presentations on the MOX approach and potential alternatives. We were briefed by Ambassador Michael Guin of the U.S. State Department and Dr. Siegfried Hecker, the former director of Los Alamos National Lab, on the terms and history of the plutonium management and disposition agreement and interactions with Russian scientific leaders that led up to this agreement. We conducted site visits and interviews at Los Alamos, the Waste Isolation Pilot Plant, or WIP, and the Savannah River site. And finally, we reviewed the prior cost analyses to assess annual funding needs for a successful disposition program, focusing on the three most recent assessments. We quickly screened out most of the potential alternatives, including some that were addressed in the plutonium working group assessment that John McWilliams was involved in, primarily because they had sufficient uncertainties in terms of cost and schedule that we concurred with the prior assessments that did not consider them near-term options for an alternative pathway. The two remaining alternatives, the baseline MOTS approach and the dilute and dispose, are those addressed in the phase one aerospace assessment of the PWG report. The aerospace team reached four primary conclusions. The PWG cost and schedule estimates were performed in reasonable accord with accepted best practices. The programmatic risks were generally underestimated for both the MOTS approach and the dilute and dispose alternative, and that the dilute and dispose alternative costs less than the MOTS. Finally, they concluded that the MOX approach is essentially non-viable at anticipated capital funding levels because of the time needed to complete construction of the MOX fuel fabrication facility up to 86 years at $350 million a year. We agreed with the first three conclusions, and importantly, the conclusion that the best case scenario for MOX was substantially more expensive than the worst case scenario for dilute and dispose. We did find that the assertions regarding the time needed to complete the MOX fuel fabrication facility at reduced funding levels were not able to take into account possible optimization of the project effort at reduced funding levels. However, as I said, we concurred with the primary conclusion regarding the relative cost. We also reviewed the Highbridge critique of the aerospace report, and the primary concern expressed by Highbridge was that the MOX risk elements and resulting impact costs are overstated and inconsistent, and that the dilute and dispose, which they refer to as downblend risk elements, are understated. While we concurred with findings that the MOX lifecycle costs in the aerospace report were overstated, as described due to the extension of the project over very long durations and the impacts of escalation, we disagreed with their contention that dilute and dispose should have a risk profile commensurate with a complex nuclear facility construction project in its early stages, given that it can begin already in existing facilities and has much smaller capital investment requirements in order to optimize its production rate. And in fact, the simplest statement that we can arrive at in terms of understanding the cost differences is that the dilute and dispose option is essentially a subset of what is needed for MOX. All of the requirements for pit disassembly and oxidization are necessary. They're necessary in either scenario. In the case of MOX, you then have to go on to convert that into nuclear fuel in the MOX fuel fabrication facility, hence the additional cost. And in particular, the dilute and dispose uses much simpler technology than MOX, so the technical risks are reduced, and it has already been demonstrated in the dispositioning of weapons plutonium material from the Rocky Flats facility. So the primary risks associated with the dilute and dispose option are not so much cost and schedule risks. They're risks associated with getting Russian concurrence with the modification of the PMDA. Such modification is allowed for in the agreement, but of course it does require concurrence. We believe there is a sufficient technical basis to perform, to constitute a good starting point for those negotiations, although there can be other factors beyond technical merits that could influence their outcome. And also receiving agreement from the state of New Mexico for the optimal regulatory pathway for dilute and dispose is another factor that can impact the overall viability, particularly due to its impacts on the WIP capacity. The bottom line in terms of relative cost, we analyze in terms of the operating cost requirement on an annual basis in unescalated dollars. The dilute and dispose option, we believe, can be executed at basically the current funding level of roughly $400 million a year, whereas successful execution of the MOX plan would require ramping up over the next 2 years or so to more like $700 to $800 million a year. In both cases, you would have to sustain that funding over the multi-decade operating life of the facility against inflation, so it would escalate over time. So I think at that point I'm over my time, so I'll conclude and we can turn to questions.
I thank all the witnesses, and now I'll recognize myself for questions. The plutonium management disposition agreement between the U.S. and Russia as amended, requires the U.S. to pay Russia $400 million to help Russia hold up its end of the deal. It's pretty hard to believe, given what Russia's up to around the world right now. How much of this assistance has been paid to Russia so far? Will any current or prior year funding be paid to Russia for these purposes in 2016? How much of these funds are currently available and on your books? And what's the plan for the $400 million in U.S. assistance mentioned in FY 2017-2018? General Klotz, I guess you're the perfect person for this question.
I am, and thank you. And anticipating that you might ask this question, Mr. Chairman, I carefully quizzed our staff. The United States has not provided Russia with any funding towards the $400 million commitment. No funds will be paid to Russia in current or prior year funding towards this commitment. And in accordance with recent congressional direction, all Russia program funds that were appropriated to meet U.S. PMDA obligations were rescinded, and there are currently no funds available within the NNSA available to support Russian plutonium disposition.
Great. Well, given that so many senior U.S. military leaders are saying they are our biggest threat, there's going to be it's going to be a virtual impossibility to get more money out of Congress for Russia. The Waste Isolation Pilot Program, or WIP, in New Mexico is a key part to making the dilute and dispose option work. But WIP has been shut down for over a year and a half due to radiation release. What risks are in dilute and dispose option, given the uncertainty surrounding WIP? Dr. Mason.
Rick, WIP is a critical asset for a number of programs. It's required for the ongoing operations of facilities, a lot of the cleanup activities, so it's certainly urgent that it be restarted. We estimated it would take roughly 5 years to prepare for initial shipments to WIP, assuming that a decision was made to transition to that pathway. You have to go through a termination process, obviously, in the MOX fuel fabrication facility. That will entail some cost, and also there's some preparatory work in terms of reaching an agreement with the Russians and establishing the framework for monitoring of the agreement, which would be done under the auspices of the International Atomic Energy Agency. And based on the visit that we made to WIP and the discussions with the federal officials there, we believe 5 years is consistent with the time frame that's envisaged for not only the restart of WIP, which is within the next year or so, but also dealing with the backlog and getting back up to a full operational status. So we don't see a major inconsistency there.
Are the cost of expanding WIP, as well as redoing the regulations and agreements with New Mexico, included in the dilute and dispose option, and how much will that cost?
The base, what you might call the baseline approach to dilute and dispose, would be following the protocols and procedures that were used to disposition the Rocky Flats material, which included diluting the plutonium oxide to 10% with the the diluent, the details of which are classified, but it's often referred to as stardust as a sort of shorthand. And that pathway is currently permitted in terms of both the transportation to WIP and the emplacement in WIP. However, it would be optimal to explore the possibility of increasing the fraction of plutonium oxide. That has the effect of reducing the duration and therefore the cost of the project and reducing the consumption of volumetric capacity at WIP. That would require additional regulatory approval, both from NRC for transportation and also permitting actions in the state of New Mexico to permit disposition in WIP.
Well, this is kind of a follow-up to that. Your red team says the, quote, perceived fundamental barriers to dilute and dispose approach, namely WIP capacity limits and the PMD compliance, are not viewed as insurmountable by the red team, but should be retired as early as possible in the planning phase for this option as possible, close quote. How quickly could you know if these fundamental barriers can be resolved successfully?
Well, as I said, you can, in terms of the WIP and New Mexico, you can initiate within the already approved framework at this 10% dilution. What you would like to do is, as quickly as possible, get to a more optimal pathway at higher concentration, and also explore with the state possibly changing the basis for calculating the amount of waste deposited in WIP. At the moment, per the agreement with the state, it's calculated based on the volume of container rather than the volume of the waste. And this, if you could get an agreement to actually look at the waste volume, that would obviate the need for any modification to the Land Withdrawal Act. As I said, those aren't a barrier to starting the process, but it would have to happen in a timely way in order to avoid consuming the full capacity of WIP at the lower dilution rate. So given that it would take 5 years to be ready to begin emplacement, there is probably time for such discussions, although obviously the near-term focus is on restart. In terms of the Russian agreement, that's a little harder to assess the duration because, quite frankly, there are factors around getting an agreement with Russians that may have nothing to do with plutonium disposition and the technical merits, and it's a little bit hard for us to, you know, consider all the possible geopolitical scenarios that might slow that down or speed it up. As we stated in the report, we believe that the U.S. has a solid negotiating position to initiate those discussions based on the fact that from a technical point of view, in our judgment, this is an acceptable disposition in that it puts the material beyond use by state or non-state actors, which is the intent of the agreement. And the fact that there has been prior modification, you know, is a good basis for the discussion. But it's a little far for us to project, you know, how other extraneous factors, be they, you know, Ukraine, Syria, pick your problem, could slow down or, you know, if things improve, speed that up. Although 5 years is probably not an unreasonable window.
Great. Thank you. Before I turn it over to the ranking member, I ask unanimous consent that non-committee members be allowed to participate in today's hearing after all subcommittee members have had an opportunity to ask questions. Is there objection? Hearing none, members will be recognized at the appropriate time for 5 minutes. With that, I turn it over to my friend and colleague from Tennessee, the ranking member, Mr. Cooper.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The topic of today's hearing is extraordinarily technical, so let me try to simplify it. I think the real news of this hearing is that most all the experts agree that there's a new and better and cheaper way to dispose of this plutonium. That's good news. Now, that option is called the dilute and dispose option. That's good news. But Congress being Congress, there's a lot of inertia, and there are some folks who may prefer what is now the worse and more expensive and slower option, which is the one we've been fooling with all these years. The key thing politically is to realize that no one here today is talking about taking money away from South Carolina. Because as the Red Team testimony says on page 5 here, let me quote, "The Red Team concluded that the dilute and dispose alternative could be executed at current annual funding levels, about $400 million per year in FY15 dollars. The real question of this hearing is, if we are forced, due to the fact that we're in love with the older, worse, more expensive technology, force American taxpayers to double or triple their commitment to South Carolina and the other parts of the supply chain. I think they're okay where they are. You know, $300 or $400 million a year, let's get the new and better technology, let's dispose of this in the new, more affordable, more reliable, more enlightened way, and let's kiss the old technology goodbye. Because we simply cannot afford to double or triple the commitment. So I have the utmost respect for my friends from South Carolina, all of them, the delegation is awesome, Mr. Wilson is particularly awesome. He does a great job supporting his constituents, but $300 or $400 million a year is enough on top of the $12 billion that various government agencies, DOE, DOD, are already spending in direct support to South Carolina. So if you look at it on a chart, and we have a chart of this, a chart double or triple it, I just don't think so. We're doing enough already. The MOX money is the little dark part on the very top there. You see it's a rising slope. So why can't we just maintain current funding levels, maintain current employment levels, maintain current job levels, but get the technology right as we dispose of this plutonium? That should do no injury to our friends in South Carolina. That should preserve our nonproliferation goals. That should help us prevent this terrible squeeze on the DOD, DOE nuclear budget, because we don't know where the funding is going to come from. I believe General Klotz, didn't you say the funds?
The Secretary of Energy, it's less than optimal for completing the project.
I love euphemisms. But so again, the question is whether we embrace this new and better approach, this more affordable, more reliable approach that is at the same cost. No one's talking about taking away money from South Carolina or from Savannah River or anything like that. The only real question for this committee is whether we force ourselves and the American taxpayer to double or triple that commitment by sticking with this old, largely outmoded technology. So I would urge my committee members to put it in that light. We're not hurting anybody here. We're just trying to choose the better technology to achieve our national security goals. Mr. McWilliams?
Thank you, sir. A couple points. We absolutely agree with the comments you've made about Savannah River. General Klotz and I and the Secretary have made repeated trips to Savannah River, and the Department very strongly believes that Savannah River is not a closure site. We want to see it have a long and prosperous future, and we are very open to work with Congress and to look for new mission to expand existing infrastructure, to look at things like creating a strategic plan, overall strategic plan for the site, finding investment to expand the mission of the lab, which has done truly extraordinary work for the country in the last couple of years. So certainly on that point. With respect to the costs, the Secretary has said numerous times that that MOX will, you know, will accomplish the mission technically, and so if money were not an issue, MOX would be a straightforward way to go. But unfortunately, as you've indicated, it is an issue. One can look at different assumptions. I'm happy to get into and explain any of those different assumptions, but whether it's Dr. Mason's group talking about $700 to $800 million in unescalated dollars, or whether it's the number that the Secretary and the Department has used recently, that essentially we believe it's about $1 billion each year for the life cycle of the project, because we used inflation, which I believe MOX Aerospace also used, using the engineering news record, which goes back to 1915, so it was a 40-year construction average, which uses about 4.2% inflation. But one can differ on inflation assumptions, which I believe is why Dr. Mason chose not to inflate. But essentially, $1 billion a year to get this done, it just doesn't seem to be within the scope of what's practical, whereas the dilution and disposal approach, we believe, would take about $400 million a year, and we would agree with Dr. Mason's report that there may be opportunities to lower that.
Mr. Cooper, if I could, let me just add to what Mr. McWilliams said about the importance of Savannah River in South Carolina to us. Looking at it strictly from the NNSA perspective, Savannah River is the site of where we do most of our tritium operations, which is one of the most important commodities that we have to deal with within the weapons program of the NNSA. In addition, other aspects of Savannah River and South Carolina are extraordinarily important to our non-proliferation mission. L Basin, K Area, H Canyon are extraordinarily important in carrying out efforts that we undertake across the globe to reduce materials that might be attractive to terrorists or would-be proliferators. So this is, we're in it for the long haul with Savannah River, and I agree with Mr. McWilliams and the Secretary that there are a lot of neat and interesting and worthy things that we would love to be doing at Savannah River over not just the short term, but the long-term future.
Thank you, General. And to reiterate, this hearing should be good news for America and good news for South Carolina. We can do both at current funding levels, but not if we double or triple it. So let's keep it where it is. Thanks.
Thank you, gentlemen. Chair, I recognize Chairman Forbes for 5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman, first of all, I want to thank you for your unbiased and analytical approach to this issue and so many more that come before the subcommittee. I thank Mr. Cooper for his persistence and passion on this issue, and just acknowledge that what seems to some as inertia may be to others due diligence. And I think the goal of everybody on this subcommittee and on this full committee is to get it right. But many of us also heard voices coming over here telling us that reducing our military significantly over the last several years was the right thing to do. When they look at the world today, they realize they were dramatically wrong on that. So we want to get it right. And Dr. Mason, the question I would ask for you is kind of following up on what the chairman asked, but in the Red Team report, you state that the WIP capacity limits and the PDMA compliance are not viewed as insurmountable. Who did the Red Team consult with at the State Department and the New Mexico State Government to come to this conclusion?
With the State Department, it was Ambassador Guin who has had responsibility for the agreement, who briefed us. And as I mentioned, we also spoke with Sig Hecker, who had a lot of early experience interacting with the Russians in some of the discussions leading up to the agreement. You know, the takeaways from those discussions were you know, first off, as I noted, there has been modification to the agreement in the past to accommodate what you might characterize as Russian national interest with their desire to proceed with a fast reactor program. And so it's not unreasonable if the decision were made to proceed down a different pathway in the U.S. national interest to propose that. However, according to Ambassador Guin, the Russians were not interested in negotiating a hypothetical. They were aware that there were discussions going on about possible...
And I don't want to cut you off because I would love for you to have time. I just have 3 minutes left. Okay. Basically, you talked to two people.
Of course, in addition to relying on the expertise on the Red Team, that's correct.
Yeah, but the Red Team was consulting on two people with the State Department. How about the New Mexico State Government?
With New Mexico, our primary interactions were at WIP with the contractors and federal officials on the site who've been the ones dealing with the state.
So you were talking to the contractors there that would be doing...
And to the DOE officials who are responsible for the negotiations that are ongoing at the moment in terms of WIP restart.
Okay,
yes.
So then basically your report on suggesting this was not viewed as insurmountable was two people at the State Department and the contractors and the people at Department of Energy at New Mexico State Government. Let me move on to a second question the chairman raised to you. How can you be confident that using a downblending option at the waste isolation pilot plant in New Mexico will only cost $400 million annually given its capacity limits and with it currently being closed?
Well, as I noted, the likely timeline for being ready to initiate shipments to WIP is 5 years down the road, which allows sufficient time for the current plans for restart and resumption of full-scale activities to unfold. So from that point of view, the current restart doesn't interfere, restart schedule does not interfere with the likely timeline for dilute and dispose. In terms of the capacity limits, there are a number of options. At the current mechanism for disposal, using the 10% dilution that was demonstrated for the Rocky Flats material, there is not sufficient capacity at WIP to accommodate all 34 metric tons based on the calculations of the needs for the EM program. However, there are a couple of options for addressing that prior to even consideration of whether or not there's any need to modify the Land Withdrawal Act, which defines that limit. Those options include some things that are within the purview of the department in terms of making more efficient use of the resource by packing containers more fully. And some of the options would require negotiation with the state of New Mexico in terms of the methodology for calculating the volume of waste that's in place.
My time is about, I've got 20 seconds left, but if you could, for the record, just submit to us, if you would, the analysis that you did to make sure those options could actually be done instead of just recognizing there are potential options. We always have a lot of options.
Sure.
We need to run down to make sure that we actually can do them and what the analysis that went behind them to do. And again, just talking to a couple people, we need a little bit more than that. So thanks, Dr. Mason. With that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
I thank the gentleman. Chair, and I recognize the gentleman from California, Mr. Aguilar, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, gentlemen. Director Mason, if you could just expand a little bit on that. In your testimony, you mentioned that 75% of the money under the dilute and dispose option, the WIP option, 75% of the money appropriated over the next 3 years would go toward the MOX facility, while the rest would go toward WIP prep. You've also mentioned a five-year window, a five-year transition and termination. So can you kind of walk me through the difference between the three- and five-year window?
Sure. The 5 years is how long we would estimate it would take to be ready to make a shipment to WIP. And part of the reason for that is for the first 3 years of that period, a substantial fraction of the funds would be required to, in an orderly and responsible way, close out the activities at the MOX fuel fabrication facility. So that would decline over the 3 years at the same, and you would use the funds that were made available then to begin ramping up the activities towards WIP emplacement, which would then occur, you know, at the end of the 5 years.
Conversely, then 75% of the allocation would go toward ramping down the existing operation. Can you talk a little bit about, you know, why, what goes into that cost structure and why that is?
Sure. So and recognize this is a rough estimate based on termination costs associated with other large capital projects. And obviously it would be the subject of a negotiation. But it's our best estimate. Some of the cost is just associated with the fact that you would want to leave the project in an appropriate physical condition, prevent egress of water and so forth, so that the asset there would be preserved. We did not consider possible alternative uses for the facility, but obviously you would want to leave the facility in a state where the investment that has been made in a, you know, seismically qualified high security facility would be preserved in the event that an alternative use was identified. So that involves some physical work to put the facility in that state, since it's open to the environment now to allow access for construction purposes. There would also be termination costs associated with the various contractual requirements for procurement of equipment and construction. Those all have to be negotiated, and you've got to continue to pay project staff during the time period that you're going through that process. So that would be the rough mix of things should the decision be made to pursue that.
And I guess that kind of leads into my next question would be, you also discussed the worst case scenario in your testimony, and you mentioned that the worst case scenario from the WIP side, the cost associated are better than the best case scenario for MOX. So can you walk us through what some of the complications could be? I'm hearing you say that those negotiations to kind of ramp down, that could be a potential variable within the wind down cost structure.
Yeah, there's obviously uncertainty associated with the termination costs. The other sorts of risks that we considered in looking at that is, as we've seen, the existing facilities that would be used, you know, can be subject to perturbations in their operations. PF4, for example, which would be used for disassembling the pits, is coming out of a process where it's been down for a period of time. And obviously over a multi-decade operating activity, that sort of thing can interrupt the operation and extend the duration. There are some capital investments needed in order to optimize the throughput on the dilute and dispose. And obviously those are projects that have associated with them risks and contingencies. Kind of ballpark estimate for adding the additional lines to carry area is around $200 million, but that's a preconceptual number. So it could increase. And then there are the standard uncertainties associated with the fact that there will be escalation of salaries and everything else over the operating life. Those are hard to estimate over that long period of time. Obviously from year to year, you can have budget fluctuations that you have to adapt to in your schedule, and those can translate into project risks in terms of cost and duration.
I appreciate you walking me through those. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll yield back.
Thank the gentleman. Chair now recognizes Mr. Kaufman for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My questions are to the cost overruns on the construction of the MOX facility. And that originally in 2002, cost estimates to build the MOX facility were $1 billion. By 2007, when construction began, the cost estimate rose to $4.8 billion in 2014, the total design and construction costs rose to $7.8 billion. I just had an issue back home with the building of a veterans hospital that was dramatically over budget. And the VA clearly is not a construction management entity, and they demonstrated that on this project. The Army Corps of Engineers has since taken over this project, and a project that started out at $600 million that wound up to, I think, almost $1.7 billion. And part of that, the legislation to fully fund the hospital was to strip the Veterans Administration of the construction management authority for any project in excess of $100 million and give that to entities like the Army Corps of Engineers who do it for a living. It's their day job. It's their focus. I want to know, I think I heard something, projects over $750 million. That seems like an awfully high number to me. Could you comment on that further?
Yes, sir. I did say that the GAO had removed us from the high-risk list for projects of that size, and you're correct, that is a large number. Essentially, as I came in and started to look at our project performance, to say it's been challenging would be overly polite, actually. And I'd be happy to discuss some of the reasons behind these overruns, if that would be helpful to you, sir. What I was referring to is that subsequent to putting it, NSA putting in their Office of Acquisition and Project Management 3 years ago, which was designed to deal with some of these problems, their performance on their smaller projects, the rest of their portfolio, has been quite good.
How do you define smaller projects?
The $800 million, below $750.
Okay.
No, and so you're correct, sir, that when you look at where the money is in these big problems and this is the problem that we face, and we face this across the department,
right,
that if you look at where the money is in these four or five large projects, they are historical projects, and we do have problems. And I can get into the reasons if you wish.
There are entities in the federal government, whether GSA, whether NAVMAC, whether the USAC or the Army Corps of Engineers, that they're professionals. I mean, this is what they do, and there are agencies of like the VA who've just lost this construction management authority, and agencies like the DOE that choose to go out on their own. And I think that it's the taxpayers that suffer for this. And I really think that. I wish agencies of the federal government would focus on what their core mission is and not venture out to areas that they have redundant, inefficient capability on. One of you respond to that.
Yes, sir. And I would point out that as we began to look, when we started looking at this a couple years ago, this project, one of the first things we did was bring the Army Corps of Engineers in to look at estimates of the MOX fabrication facility construction cost. At the time, this was almost 2 years ago, and it was a preliminary analysis, they concluded that they felt the MOX fabrication facility would cost $10 billion at that point. There's been underfunding for 2 years, so I'm sure that if they were to look at it again, it would be higher than that. You're raising a very legitimate point given the history of the department. The reason that we've put in very substantial project management changes is because of these problems. I'll just point out one, not to take away from your point, the value of your point, sir, is that NSA, for example, immature design is one of the biggest problems we've faced.
Well, and then let me say, okay. The Army Corps of Engineers was not bought in at the beginning.
No, sir.
Correct. So, yeah, of course, they're pricing the mismanagement that's already been done on the project and into that figure. Oh, go ahead, please.
No, I was just going to make one point, and then we can get into others as you wish. The immature design, so we get into design, build, design, is a huge problem. And so actually NSA now has a rule that has mandated that we will not get into nuclear projects unless we have 90% design complete. So I recognize that's only one point, but that's to address one of the biggest issues that we have had.
It's just unnecessary and inefficient to have these redundant abilities created in every department of the federal government. It is unnecessary. There are elements in the federal government that do this for a living. And I hear the same thing in the VA when we were going through this process about how they were going to get better, about how they were working through it. And if we look back at the the VA historically, you will find throughout the decades they made the same commitments and never delivered. And again, it is a waste of taxpayer dollars to have this redundant capability. It needs to go away. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you, gentlemen. Chair, now I recognize the gentleman from California, Mr. Gary Mindy, for 5 minutes.
Thank you. First, a quick question. Arriva has claimed that construction is nearly 70% complete. Do you agree? And how much work would have to be redone to move into this dilute process?
Thank you, sir, for the question. We don't agree. And the reason we don't agree is that we are required to look at cost to complete.
That's so fine. How much would have to be redone if you're going to this other dilute process?
Well, we're at 35% to 41%. That's where we are, sir. So we, and with, if you're referring to rework, sir, currently the contractor is running at a rate of 25% rework.
Thank you. Wanted to get that on the record. Russia's using a fast reactor system. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
And how far along are they on their process?
The BN-800 is nearing operations as we speak, sir.
I see. What's the UK doing in its disposition of plutonium?
Actually, one reason that we included on our team some representatives from the UK is because they are also going through a process of trying to analyze their options for dealing with a considerable quantity of civil plutonium, 120 tons. At the moment, actually maybe 140, correct myself. At the moment, their current plans have not been fully finalized. They are considering a MOX option for a portion of that inventory, although there is some that will be unsuitable for MOX due to its chemical composition. But they are also pursuing R&D into geological disposition pathways in parallel. They are not as far along in terms of their decision process.
Are they considering a fast reactor?
Not to my knowledge, no.
The analysis here indicates that an American fast reactor doesn't exist. Is that correct? It doesn't exist for this purpose.
In fact, there isn't an operating fast reactor in the U.S. The last facility, the fast flux test reactor at Hanford, was shut down.
Fast reactor?
The FFTF, no, it's a different facility. We have not operated one for a number of years.
Did we have an integral fast reactor operating in the United States?
Idaho has in the past operated fast breeder reactors, but not for a number of years.
So we actually had the technology. Is that technology in existence today?
Arguably, the technology was developed in the U.S. originally, actually, as was most of the technology behind the MOX option. However, we are not currently aggressively pursuing other possible reactor technologies in general.
Does GE have the license for the integral fast reactor?
We'll have to check that. I don't want to make something up on the fly.
It does. I'm surprised you don't know. In fact, I'm not at all surprised. I guess I should not be surprised because the department seems to have dismissed the fast reactor as an option and moved on to study the MOX and the downblend and dispose option. Is that correct?
Actually, sir, when we did our 2014 study as part of that, we did a very actually comprehensive study, NE did, on the fast reactor because, as the Russians are showing, a fast reactor would accomplish the mission. The issue became that it would be a new start. The cost estimate was approximately $50 billion, and it would take many, many years with complexity. But it was looked at. We have a study which
I
think...
Is Russia willing to sell its fast reactor to us?
I can't answer that. I haven't asked them that.
Well, apparently they have one. Apparently, they're using it for the very same purpose that we would use this, and you didn't bother asking Russia or didn't bother looking at their technology. Is that correct?
To my knowledge, we've not asked Russia whether we
Why?
Buy a reactor.
Why?
I don't have an answer for that, sir.
I could comment.
I find
perhaps
that unacceptable, but please tell me why, since there is a technology available, a fast reactor available in Russia, you cited the name of it, why didn't you look at that as an option? Yeah, any of you, three of you.
I can comment on the red team. We did consider the fast reactor option in our analysis.
Did you consider the Russian fast reactor?
Our consideration was not a specific fast reactor design, so it was.
General, did you consider it?
No, I did not.
Why not?
I wasn't part of this review, and the NNSA doesn't build reactors. That's another part of the Department of Energy. But what I understand,
I find it incomprehensible. We're looking at a multi tens of billions of dollars here, and we know that there exists in Russia a fast reactor that is operating or will very soon be operating to dispose of plutonium, and the brilliant scientists and generals didn't bother to ask if maybe the Russian reactor or something similar to it could be used to this purpose?
Gentleman's
is that correct?
Gentleman's time has expired. Chair now recognizes the gentleman from South Carolina, Mr. Wilson, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Ranking Member Cooper, for your leadership. And I'm grateful to be here with NNSA, with DOE, with National Labs. I have a unique perspective of your professionalism. I'm the only member of Congress who's actually worked at the Savannah River site and worked at DOE. And so I know the professionalism of the people that you work with. In fact, it's my humble opinion, as an indication of your success, has been the level of completion of the mixed oxide fuel fabrication facility. Indeed, it has been completed 67.3%. We have 160,000 cubic yards of structural concrete in place. I remember the first time I visited, it looked like a forest of rebar. And so I've seen it come to life. And the thought of creating a facility that can take weapons-grade plutonium and convert it into fuel, I sincerely hope that we can proceed. And further, 19 of 31 of the modules are installed in the pipe gallery. We have the glove boxes received in place. Over and over again, there actually has been, a tremendous success and achievement. And with that in mind, too, General Klotz, the state of South Carolina, and I feel like as I'm concerned about South Carolina, this is, of course, adjacent to our beloved Georgia, Peach State. And so this is a concern of both states, that the agreement of our state was to accept the highly radioactive weapons-grade plutonium and to process it and move it out. It's a concern for the people that I represent. That's the greatest concern that we have. With that in mind, what's been proposed is to use the waste isolation pilot plant in New Mexico. But General Klotz, is the commitment still to South Carolina, to the people of our state, Georgia, our neighbors, that indeed this weapons-grade plutonium will be removed from our presence?
Yes, Congressman, it most definitely is. And, of course, one of the questions becomes, you know, which pathway will get there sooner and quicker?
But, gosh, to convert weapons-grade plutonium into fuel as opposed to some inert storage facility and that goes to WIP itself. And another person who has an extraordinary clarity on this issue is Bill Richardson, the former governor of New Mexico, former Secretary of Energy. And in the Aiken Standard newspaper on August 21st, he had a letter which was printed to Senator Harry Reid saying, quote, "As a former Secretary of Energy and Governor of New Mexico, I can assure you that WIP, in our lifetimes, has the same chance of accepting weapons-grade plutonium that Yucca Mountain has for accepting spent nuclear fuel. It is self-deluding to claim otherwise." Is the Secretary correct or not?
Well, we have great respect for the Secretary and his service to the country. He may have forgotten that there's already 4.8 metric tons of plutonium that has been delivered in exactly this format into WIP.
But we also know, too, as we're talking about this technology, that the MOX facility that currently exists in France. And so as we're talking about the technology, it has been proven, and it will work. With that in mind, at the website, there was an incident where there was airborne radiation particles in February 2014 at the website. It is certainly general been placed in a closed facility. Is it currently open or not?
It is not currently operational. The expectation is by sometime during next year, the year 2016, it'll be up and operational again. This is a very, very important site to the Department of Energy, to the nation, because it is where we can store transuranic waste. And so the Secretary and the entire department are seized with the importance of returning WIP to full operation as soon as we possibly can.
And so you indicate it will be open within the next 2 years?
By the end of 2016.
And hey, as I conclude, I appreciate your service, but I can't wait to invite my colleagues to visit the mixed oxide fuel facility, MOX facility. It's adjacent to the Augusta National Golf Course, Sage Valley Golf Course. It's a world-class place. I want John Garamendi to be there and see it. So thank you very much.
Well, I can attest, Congressman, you give a great tour through the facility.
Yeah, gentlemen's time has expired. I thank the gentleman. Chairman, I recognize Mr. Norcross for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and certainly Ranking Member Cooper for allowing me to sit in. Having spent the better part of my life in the industry, I hear much of the testimony, and it's not unique to this project, but the MOX facility, when it first started to put a shovel in the ground, how much of the project was design finished? What percentage?
Sir, obviously I wasn't there, but from my understanding, it was about 20-25% design and complete, which is obviously a significant problem.
So the original cost estimates were based on a 20% completed design?
Somewhere between 20-25, yes, sir.
We usually call that throwing darts in the night and hoping you hit a bullseye. So the original premise here was horrible, at least. How far along, you said it was 90% design completed now. From when it actually started, how many design changes took place in that time? What I'm trying to ascertain here is the incremental increases and why they occurred.
Sure. Sorry, I can't give you the exact number, though. I'll take it for the record and get
round
you the
numbers.
Exact number. But the issue that you're referring to is exactly on point, which is it's this design-build-design problem. This project was originally based on, as Congressman Wilson mentioned, some French designs. The problem is that this is a weapon-grade plutonium, and the French design is civilian civil plutonium, and there are a number of complexities, including NRC licensing and other things, robotics, the way we approach safety in this country. And so the original the complexities of the design were not properly appreciated, in addition to the regulatory costs, and that is one of the major issues. But the issue that you're focusing on was one of the first issues that we focused on when we put together our review, which is why the NNSA now requires 90% design complete before it will go forward.
And we understand we want to get things completed very quickly. Just start and we'll figure it out.
That's what happened.
Which is the most expensive way to ever do a project.
Yes, sir.
So let's move on, saying if we go to WIPs, is that 100% design, the type of facility we would build?
WIP, first of all, was used in our study, in the 2014 study, as a reference case. And the reason it was a reference case is it was the only existing repository that could accept defense TRU waste. And as I mentioned, 4.8 metric tons of this plutonium using dilute and dispose has been shipped there, including a small amount from Savannah River. So the process is proven. Dr. Mason could speak in more technical terms about the technical risk there if you wish, but it is a proven process that we've been using. In fact, until the incident that was referred to at WIP, plutonium was scheduled to be continued to be shipped.
So when we look at that, and the agreement is with Russia, and it was mentioned earlier, What makes us think that they'll agree to this change?
The and General Klotz can speak to this. We did have, in addition to what Dr. Mason said, we did about a year ago have a DOE State Department team go over and talk with the Russians. And basically, the message it was a good conversation, because the agreement, as I think we're all aware, provides disposition by reactor or other methods as agreed to by the parties, which is what the Russians availed themselves of in 2010. So the team went over, had the conversation, and basically the message that came back was the Russians were willing to have a conversation, but they said you need to figure out what direction you want to go in, then come back and we'll have a conversation. But I think General Klotz also can give you some firsthand.
No, I think Mr. McWilliams, sir, has given a very fair rendition of the response we've gotten from technical people on the Russian side. As recently as a couple weeks ago, Secretary Moniz raised it in a conversation with Mr. Sergei Kirienko, who's the head of Rosatom in Russia, and basically was the same response. We recognize that you acceded to our desire to amend the agreement in 2010 to allow for the approach which the Russians are now pursuing. When you have a plan, come back to us, and we'll sit down and negotiate. But also, I think, as Dr. Mason laid out, there are a lot, I've spent a lot, most of my lifetime in negotiations with the Soviet Union and Russia. There are a lot of other political, economic, strategic variables that get injected into any discussion with them on any issue in this area.
Well, you certainly said a mouthful there, because you're suggesting that the Russians are going to be reasonable. And I guess we all hope that, but certainly that's a large mountain to climb. I yield back my time. Thank you.
I thank the gentleman. Chair, and I recognize Dr. Winstrup for 5 minutes.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. McWilliams, thank you for being here today. I know we've had some of these discussions before that I'd like to talk about today.
And yes, sir.
I know you understand that I'm frustrated with DOE's recent decision to demobilize the uranium enrichment RD&D project in Piketon, Ohio, and I think it's incredibly short-sighted to do this, especially in light of the Iran deal, where we are seeing that this world's largest sponsor of state terrorism is now maintaining 6,000 centrifuges and continue to enrich uranium. DOE's decision to demobilize this project was based on data that was collected for a report that DOE was mandated by Congress to complete in April, which we received Monday night. And my question is, if the United States must have the technology for a fully domestic source of enriched uranium to support our nuclear navy, what's DOE's long-term plan to ensure that we do not lose the research and the workforce gains that were made in Piketon, Ohio, while also maintaining immediate production capabilities for a domestic source of enriched uranium? It seems like we're diving into a black hole, shutting things down when they're spinning things up, and for a national security interest, we need to keep this maintained and ready to run.
Thank you, sir. And I want to answer that. I also wanted to say, in a related subject that we've been discussing, that per conversations that we had with you this week, we have been working to finalize our plan for spending under the CR pursuant to direction from the Secretary. We will be giving updated funding guidance and direction to FBP, the contractor, today to spend at a higher level to avoid involuntary layoffs for D&D activities at Portsmouth, which I recognize is separate, sir. And so the contractor is going to issue a notice to employees later today. To go to your exact question, sir, as we talked about last week, the first important point here is these potential layoffs are clearly regrettable, but the administration remains committed to reestablishing a domestic enrichment capability for national security.
My question, though, right now, I appreciate that, yeah, is we are going to have a time down.
Yes, sir.
Where we do not have this capability up and running, and that's my concern.
Yep.
The other thing is, when I spoke to Secretary Moniz last night, I said, do you have an estimate of what the cost is to shut down the ACP, this project?
Yep.
And he said, no, I don't know. Let me get back to you. Now, to me, that's a huge component to the equation.
Sure.
If it costs $1 billion to shut it down,
no, it does not.
And I'm just throwing this out as an example.
Yep.
But you don't know. He didn't know. And it costs $350 million, say, to maintain it for 7 years, and we're able to flip a switch and produce what we need to protect our country at a moment's notice.
Right.
then that's the wise business decision. But right. He didn't even know.
Okay, well,
I'm very concerned about that. You're making decisions on a report we were supposed to have in April that we didn't get.
Yes, sir.
And didn't get a chance to weigh in, and you don't even know what these costs are, and you're making a decision. I'm sorry, I find that really irresponsible and a threat to our national security capabilities.
So, sir, as we discussed, what we're talking about doing is having to stand down 120 test centrifuges. We do not have a capability. Those centrifuges don't have a capability today to provide us the material that we need. But the cost that you're referring to is approximately $100 to $150 million. Under our agreements with Centris, they have obligations to pick up a very large portion of that, obviously provided they have the financial means to do that. That's the answer.
So let me ask you this. So when it comes to, say, tritium, I mean,
yes, sir.
You say that the AC-100 design, that technology is as good as we have right now.
Yes, sir. That is the technology that we plan to use.
Okay. And the report indicates that building out a national security plant based on that technology would require 1,400 centrifuges.
Yes, sir.
So how can we meet our tritium needs and build out these 1,400 centrifuges if we're dismantling the 120 that we have?
Because the 120 that we have, the purpose of those was to continue to prove out the technology, and they've essentially neared the end of their useful life. They would not be centrifuges that we would add into the 1,400 for a variety of reasons. So what we are doing immediately, because we're not standing down, this is important to say this, that we are continuing with the program. We're not putting in a cold standby. We will issue an RFI to build out. The issue, however, sir, is that it's going to take 5 to 7 years to reestablish that capability, but we are starting that now.
What is our capability when this plan is played out on a moment's notice to produce enriched uranium that we may need based on whatever may happen?
That capability does not exist today. It does not exist today. It will take us 5 to 7 years to reestablish, but the standing down of the 120 centrifuges does not affect
that. But you say that they're at the end, but they're the only thing that we have.
But they're not producing material for
but
this
they
purpose.
Could. My time has expired.
Thank you, sir.
Gentleman's time has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Nebraska, Mr. Fortenberry, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for accommodating my interest in sitting on the committee, and I thank the members of the committee for your consent and allowing me to testify before you today and ask you questions. I'm Jeff Fortenberry from Nebraska. I'm on the Appropriations Committee and the Energy and Water Subcommittee. So we see this issue as well. And frankly, if I could be just right up front with you, this conversation would be very boring if it wasn't so essential, because we keep talking about the same things over and over again, and it's been repeated today, but I want to go back through the numbers. In 2002, the initial cost estimate was $1.07 billion. It's now $4.8 billion. Today, it's estimated to be $7.8 billion. So every year we go through this debate. This year, the Appropriations Committee allocated in the committee mark $345 million, which is not enough to build it out. It's not enough to close it down. So we're kind of saying, sort of, maybe we'll continue to think about it if it's possible in the time that we have while we're serving, but then somebody else might have to deal with it later. We'll punt. You're doing that, we're doing that, everybody's doing that. So a decision has to be made whether or not this is a viable project or whether the alternatives are real enough to continue to pursue an alternative pathway. From my perspective, this is a fragile program with a very unclear future. And the alternatives that have been laid out there are a responsible way to look at a diversion of limited public resources to deal with a very significant problem. Now, I was very interested in the line of questioning that Mr. Garamondi, who is gone now, was asking about alternative disposal through fast reactors. But first, let me ask you this. How much funding has been spent to date on the MOX facility and its related programs and infrastructure? So we've got various numbers floating out there, so could you give us your number? And then what percentage of completion are we in regarding the facility? What percent complete are we in? And do you and the contractors agree on these figures?
Thank you, sir. The amount of funding on the MOX facility itself through July was about $4.8 billion. When you add in the rest of the program, you're north of $6 billion, because you have to That adds in the waste solidification building, which is essentially complete, and some of the other program
costs. So totally completed, the cost would be what?
For the whole life cycle, for the whole program.
However you define it.
Yeah, well, it's important that we look at the whole program, not just the MOX project. There are various estimates. Our number was north of $30 billion, but estimates range as high as $50 billion.
Okay, so appropriating $345 million a year, what does that buy?
Nothing.
How could that money be better used?
$400 million. Well, I think we agree with the Red Team's conclusions, essentially, and General Klotz.
Now, by the way, during the appropriations debate, I offered an amendment to reduce the program by a very small amount, simply to divert the money to other nonproliferation programs, more so as a statement to begin to try to have a reasoned debate about the quality of this investment. And I really did appreciate, frankly, up front, the conversation about how you successfully, if we went another direction, successfully transition this commitment to the South Carolina, Georgia community in other ways, and I think that's very important. But I think we have to look at the mission of this particular policy and whether or not it's feasible.
I agree, and as I said at the outset, from looking at from the perspective of NNSA and the whole range of portfolio that we have, that includes a rather large weapons program as well as nonproliferation, emergency response, and counterterrorism, it's a question of, in a constrained budget, how can you afford to cover the many tasks which the administration and the Congress have asked us to do? So if we can achieve the disposition of 34 metric tons of excess weapons-grade plutonium through a less costly way than the path that we're currently embarked upon, that is why this is of such interest.
Can I ask one other question? Who has the prime contract for building the facility?
I apologize. CBI Shaw. And then Areva is also involved. It's MOX Services, which is a joint venture between both companies. Areva, going forward, if we built the project, would handle the marketing as well.
Areva is a French company.
Yes, sir.
And they purchased Shaw or have...
No, they're Shaw. A separate company. They have a joint venture, which they call MOX Services.
But it's my understanding Areva took over some major component recently. Is that correct? The nature of the agreement of the relationship?
Well, Areva's had some reorganization in other areas. They've had some financial issues, and so they have had reorganization in France.
How much of the $345 million goes to a French company?
I can't answer that, sir. I can.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank the gentleman. Chair, now recognizes the vice chairman of the committee, Mr. Lamborn, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I know we've touched on this some already, but let me get into a little more detail because this is so important. And Dr. Mason, I'd like to direct a few questions to you. About the PMDA, the Plutonium Management and Disposition Agreement with Russia, depending on who you talk to, it seems like you get different answers about whether it's even possible to renegotiate that or how difficult it might be. Can you elaborate on that, please?
Sure. I think the first point that we considered was, did we ourselves consider, in particular, the dilute and dispose alternative, an acceptable disposition? Because if you can't convince yourself, you would obviously have little chance of convincing the Russians. And so our conclusion was that it was an acceptable pathway in the sense that it did put the material beyond use for all practical purposes and therefore met the intent of disposition. So having satisfied ourselves on that question, you then have to ask is, okay, if we've convinced ourselves, what are the prospects for reaching an agreement with the Russians? As I noted in my remarks, and I think General Klotz has made similar remarks, from the point of view of entering into the discussion, we judge that there is a reasonable negotiating position for the U.S. based on the fact that first, as I said, it is an acceptable disposition pathway in terms of putting the material beyond use, akin to what has been called the spent fuel standard, which was first discussed in a 1994 National Academy study, not identical, but meeting many of the same kind of characteristics, and the fact that there has been prior modification to the agreement to accommodate Russian national interest. The difficulty is that may all be true and you still might not reach a conclusion for reasons that have nothing to do with the merits of the argument. That's a little harder for us to judge as a technical committee. We are not diplomats, and so to some extent, we viewed that broader question as one that was a little bit beyond our purview and really restricted our analysis to, is this a viable technical pathway and is there a good basis for negotiation? And on those two points, we felt that there was reasonable basis for negotiation.
Now, for any one of you then, if there was a renegotiation, would there be any risk to the whole issue of proliferation? If you're saying, Dr. Mason, that some of these things were beyond what you felt really comfortable, I'd like to know from the rest of you who might be a little more comfortable with that question, is proliferation being brought into question?
I think there are, the major concern we have with, and the reason why we pursue disposing of excess weapons-grade plutonium is if you have no need for it, it is best to get rid of it so that it does not fall into the wrong hands, whether that be would-be proliferators at some point or if it turns out to be terrorists who would use special nuclear materials for their activities. So that's fundamentally why both sides in this agreement have pursued getting rid of this excess weapons-grade plutonium. At the same time, we've also been getting rid of excess high-enriched uranium that's no longer necessary for weapons programs. And in fact, through a very successful program we have with the Russians that's referred to as megatons to megawatts, we've actually been burning that uranium in U.S. civil nuclear reactors for a number of years for purposes beyond which it was originally intended for.
I think there is another important point on this which has to do with the timing. The original agreement had an objective of beginning the process by 2018. Our understanding is the Russians are close to that, maybe delayed a little bit. But even in the event that they're successful on their current schedule and start their fast reactor, it's highly unlikely that they would begin dispositioning their weapons plutonium until the U.S. was dispositioning its. They have other sources of plutonium that they would use. So you will not begin the disposition in either country until both countries are prepared to move. So there is a certain urgency in beginning, just because of, as General Klotz mentioned, the whole point is to not have it sitting around susceptible to any sort of untoward use. And obviously, the shorter the duration before you get rid of it, the greater the reduction in risk.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
I think the General Chairman recognizes himself for a second round of questions. General Klotz, the Russians sought an amendment to the PMDA with the United States, and the Obama administration signed off on it, allowing Russia to use its 34 metric tons of excess plutonium in a, quote, fast breeder, close quote, reactor. Is such a reactor technically capable of producing additional plutonium for Russia? How much plutonium will Russia put into this reactor, and has the U.S. been able to gain access to the reactor to make sure we know what they're up to?
If I could, Mr. Chairman, not being a nuclear scientist, if I could defer that to Dr. Mason, I think he'd probably give you a more technically correct and precise answer than I could possibly give.
I thank you. Dr. Mason.
I think that the first point on the Russian program and the reason that the Russians proposed it is it was their intent to build a fast reactor anyway. So in some sense, there was no additional cost incurred to build a special purpose facility. Of course, that reactor could be fueled on either civil plutonium or weapons-grade plutonium, and it is intended by its design to be a breeder. In other words, to produce more fissile material as part of its operation for energy purposes. So through its operation, you will be making more plutonium. The modification to the PMDA provides requirements for the operating cycle under which the weapons-grade plutonium is burned in order to change the isotopic composition in a way that the plutonium produced in the reactor is not suitable for use in weapons. And that's part of the agreement as amended in 2010.
Okay. General Klotz, as a rough order of magnitude estimate, how much did it cost the U.S. to produce the 34 metric tons of plutonium that we're talking about in the PMDA, and what were the production costs in dollars, human health, and environmental damage?
I don't know the cost of how much it cost us to produce 34 metric tons. I could take that for the record and give you an estimate of of that process, which took place, unfolded over years during the Cold War period.
Do you have a no rough estimate?
No, sir.
Okay. With that, I will yield to the ranking member for any questions he may have.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Although this has been a technical and calm hearing so far, I think a couple of bits of testimony are truly startling. I, at least, was amazed. One was the difference in outlook on completion of the MOX facility. The company seems to think it's 67% complete. The owner, the United States government, seems to think it's 35 to 41% complete. Whoa. The contractor is supposed to be working for us, and we see things so differently. Like, whoa, that's a big failure of communication at the very least. Mr. McWilliams?
Yes, sir. Well, we do have longstanding difference with the contractor on this point. Let me explain our numbers in a little more detail. We are required to look at percentage completion, so cost to complete. So our current estimate is $12 to $14 billion for the MOX fabrication facility. As I mentioned, the Army Corps of Engineers, when they looked at it a couple years ago, were around $10 billion and up, but that was preliminary, and now there's been delays for 2 years, so I can't speak for them, but it would be, I'm sure it would be a little bit north of that. So if we spent $4.8 billion so far, you just do the math and you put that over $12 to $14 billion and you get the range that I gave you of 35 to 41%. Now, in addition, Congressman Wilson's absolutely right in the picture shows that there has been a lot of work done and some very good work in terms of civil engineering, et cetera. This is a very, very complex project, and the more difficult work remains to be done. And that tends to be the instrumentation. The piping is very complicated. I mentioned a 25% rework rate. The contractors estimated 2.5% rework rate, and we're running 25% at this point. So that there is a difference in view, and that's the reasons.
And if I could add, we noted in our report that the relationship between the NNSA, the project staff, and the contractor is not good. There is little trust in both directions. There are reasons that both parties to that disagreement will point to for their distrust. It does mean that should the decision be made that it is necessary to stick with MOX, that has to be addressed because it is not functioning well in terms of the relationship at the moment. And the disagreement about the percent complete is really just one manifestation of that disconnect. And actually, it's both, percent is a fraction, and the disagreement is both in the numerator, how much work has been done, and in the denominator, how much work is it going to take to complete the project.
Well, the second most startling bit of information was the one that Mr. McWilliams just referenced again. Any project that has 25% rework, like, oh my gosh, because that means you build it, then you have to tear it down 25% and redo it. So we get to pay twice as a taxpayer? Like, wow. And then it turns out there's even a disparity there because the company says it's only 2.5%. Well, this is unbelievable. This really gets to core competency and viability of the project, I would think. Mr. McWilliams?
Sir, just to clarify one thing, I can't speak for the contractors whether they would today say that it's 2.5%. The numbers we're seeing is 25%. What I was saying is in their original planning, which produced some of these cost estimates, the assumption was 2.5%.
Dr. Mason was telling me earlier about the faulty incentive structure that NNSA or someone had put out there where it was fee-based on placement of equipment. So in some cases, apparently, the company would go ahead and place the equipment, even though it blocked access to other equipment, just so they get their fee. So we would pay to place the equipment, to move the equipment, and then replace the equipment. So in that case, we got to pay three times for the same work. That seems too unbelievable to be true.
Well, and I think that's an origin of some of the distrust. The as you know, you do wind up essentially paying 3x in those instances. The contractual arrangement as it stands right now is really not functioning for the management of the project. The project has been without a baseline for really nearly 3 years. And so again, as we stated in the report, if the decision is to continue with the MOX, there would have to be what I would judge to be a rather difficult negotiation take place. It's not a case where you can simply, as might occur in the, you know, if you were building a home, fire the contractor and hire a new one. Reva actually owns the IP associated with it, and so there would have to be significant restructuring of the contractual arrangement in order to provide a rational basis for future work.
But I think if I could, Mr. Cooper, I think this goes part of the distress which exists has a lot to do with uncertainty. I mean, this is a program, this is a project of which there has been some great uncertainty over the past couple years. It's uncertainty that's felt, you know, by the federal force down there that has responsibility for oversight. It's uncertainty that's felt by the contractor and the labor force, and it's uncertainty felt by the good citizens of South Carolina and Georgia.
This brings me to a final point that wasn't revealed in testimony yet, but it was in General Klotz's written testimony, where he says, if a decision were made to complete construction of the facility, the MOX facility, the contractor would be requested to provide a baseline change proposal to complete the facility at a specified annual funding level, and a new contract cost proposal would be negotiated. This just gets us to the point that Dr. Mason was just talking about. In a homeowner situation, you don't like the contractor, you fire him, you get somebody new. Here, Areva owns the IP. You essentially can't fire them. They're already failing to communicate. We're on a completely different page, maybe a different planet on this. And then we would have to enter in new contract cost negotiations with them. These wouldn't be negotiations. This would be a hostage taking. And we're already the hostage here. We would have no leverage at all in this situation, would we?
The reason we haven't done a baseline change proposal is essentially we've been waiting to do studies to see where we are, because as you're aware, that's a multiple year process, many million dollars required. And so at this point, at least in our perspective, there have been numerous studies, and it's pretty clear that the MOX project is going to be very, very expensive. I would also say that we've been talking about Areva a lot, but it is MOX Services, which is a joint venture. I think that the purpose here is certainly not to demonize the contractor in any way, but it is a joint venture between CBI and Areva.
And I would also like to point out that in noting that there was little trust, that was in both directions,
yeah,
in the sense that the contractor does not feel that they have the trust and confidence in the department either, partly for the reasons of uncertainty that were mentioned. And so, you know, like any relationship, it's not working in both directions.
Failure to communicate is usually two ways. Final point, when it comes to not dealing with NNSA, but with the NRC, it was my impression from talking to Dr. Mason that the MOX joint venture approach was to engage in redundancy. When they wanted to lower risk, they would have redundant or backup systems, so that way essentially we get to pay twice. But that had the net effect of lowering risk, but it's a completely different approach than we use in this country to solve problems. Could you elaborate, Dr. Mason?
Actually, the redundancy that you refer to, I think, even predates the contract award. It goes back to some of the original design thinking. You know, it is illustrative of a challenge that I've seen, for example, when we looked at the uranium production facility in a different exercise. It's been mentioned already some of the difficulties that the department has encountered in setting requirements. And I'm reminded of a remark that I saw attributed to General Odierno when asked why some of the DOD major acquisitions have not yielded weapons systems. The phrase he used was utopian requirements. And I think that's very apt in this instance. And sometimes fear of what the regulator might do, whether it's the NRC or DOE in its self-regulating mode for other facilities, has on occasion led to very conservative decision-making that gives the appearance of reducing risk, but may actually increase it because of the cost that's occurred in avoiding difficulties that may or may not actually materialize. Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Chair, now I recognize the gentleman from California, Mr. Garamendi, for 5 minutes.
Thank you. From the previous testimony, there was no discussion with Russia about the BN-800. And is that correct?
To my knowledge, sir, there wasn't, but I'd be happy to go back to find out.
Thank you. Was there any discussion with General Electric Hitachi about their fast reactor design?
The analysis that we looked at of fast reactor option was actually based on work that had been done by the Department's Office of Nuclear Energy, which had been doing an analysis of a potential fast reactor as a component of the nuclear energy mission. That did include consideration of a number of the different designs that have been proposed, including those that have been mentioned. And the reason that our group, the Red Team, did not further pursue that option is because were you to pursue a fast reactor option, you would have to build both a fuel fabrication facility, which is the current topic, and a reactor. So because of that, it did not offer any obvious...
Did you explore the potential for doing both of those?
Yes, we did, relying on this analysis that has been done by the Office of Nuclear Energy, which I leave it to my colleagues to...
Mr. McWilliams?
Yes, sir. The Office of Nuclear Energy did have conversations with GE. I can get you more information if that would be helpful for you, sir.
Was it helpful to your analysis?
It was incorporated into the study.
How was it helpful to your analysis?
The analysis that our working group, which included representatives from NE, did, and they did a very comprehensive study on the fast reactors, which we'd be happy to give you another copy of. And the central conclusion was that while it would accomplish the mission, it would be roughly a $50 billion project.
At an expenditure level of $300 or $400 million a year forever.
You're correct, sir, that we... It was $500 million, and the reason we looked at that is so we could compare all options.
Well, I would just simply share with everybody, it's a fool's errand to base all of this analysis on the appropriation level rather than on what it would cost to do the process.
We would be happy to give you the unconstrained funding number. Well, it's still very, very substantial, sir, for a brand new...
I'll make the point once again. You did not analyze any of this based upon what it would actually cost, but rather assuming a funding level from the federal government that, frankly, would stretch all of these options out to kingdom come.
And he did look at an unconstrained case, sir. No, our NE group did a study this thick on this.
I don't care how thick the study is.
But they did a very comprehensive, which did look at unconstrained funding, and I'd be happy to provide it for the record.
Did anybody ask General Electric, Hitachi, what it would cost to build the reactor
and the fuel fabrication system? My understanding is they had extensive conversations with GE, and I'd be happy to provide more information for you.
Please do so, and when will you deliver it to me?
Let me go back, and we'll do it promptly, sir.
No, that's not an answer. Next week?
I will get
week
you.
Week after next.
I will get you information by the end of next week, sir.
Thank you. I think I still have some more time. Let's talk about the dilute process. What exactly is it? And what is the result of the dilute? What is the nature of the material at the end of the result of the dilute?
Sure. So the first step in the process is to convert the material from whatever form it's in, which is typically metal for the majority of the material, into oxide, which is accomplished in a furnace, an oxidizing furnace. That oxide then is mixed in a very simple mechanical operation with a diluent that's given the name Stardust. The exact constituents of it are classified because it's intended to make it very difficult to reconstitute the plutonium into a weapon-usable form.
Very difficult, but possible to reconstitute it using a mechanical process?
Yes, because in order to get the plutonium out, you would have to do a chemical process, and the constituents of the diluent are designed to make that chemical process very costly and difficult. So the final material you end up with is a blend of oxides, just loose oxides, like looks like sand you would find on a beach. It isn't, however, very much like sand you'd find on a beach.
Could you please deliver to me a detailed description of what that is and what the end result of that process is and the potential for reconstitution of that material back into a plutonium, into a weapons-grade plutonium? Can you do that?
Gentlemen's time's expired.
Thank you.
We can do that, sir.
Chair, now recognize Mr. Wilson for the final questions of the afternoon.
Well, thank you so much, Mr. Chairman. Indeed, I appreciate the information being provided today. It's really reassuring to me as a former DOE employee, a person who's worked at the Savannah River site. Actually, your service gives me confidence because I know of the health and safety that is at the Savannah River site. The level of populations of South Carolina, Georgia that really appreciate the record of safety that we have at that site. Indeed, I also share with my colleagues a concern about the cost, obviously, and I've been asking about that since day one. And so much of it, and there's been terminology used, percentage of design completion, rework, utopian requirements, so much of the increase in cost, as has been explained to me, has been due to change of specifications. It's in good faith by everybody involved. It's not because of persons not being interested in health and safety, but because you are interested in health and safety. It's due to changes in technology over the years. The experience that has been with the facility in France over and over again, and that's my interest about health and safety. But as we do talk about the cost, Dr. Mason, the red team had a situation of disagreeing with aerospace relative to the $47 billion life cycle cost. So what was the disagreement?
Yes. Of the four primary conclusions of the aerospace report, the one where we did have a different conclusion related to their analysis under constrained funding scenarios. So while we agreed with their overall conclusion in terms of the relative cost of the two options in their phase one report, the difficulty was that they did not have access to the detailed resource-loaded schedules that would allow them to re-optimize the schedule at different funding levels. And so they did what I think any of us would have done with that same limited information and made their best estimate, but it really didn't give them the flexibility to try and re-optimize and replan the work, and therefore extended the duration in the case of $350 million a year cap on construction out to 86 years. And we believe that you could do better than that with a proper replan of the schedule and a re-baseline.
And I appreciate that. And it's always actually been frustrating to me about life cycle cost. By using that terminology, I think of purchasing a car. If you use the life cycle cost, what the cost of it was and what the cost of maintaining it, filling it with fuel, whatever, insurance, goodness, you'd buy no car. Who would know what the cost would be? You'd have to have 10 red teams to figure out what the cost would be, but the net result is you wouldn't do it. You wouldn't buy a vehicle. And so that's why I hope we look at this, and that's the reason that I brought the map or the picture today of the facility, because whether it's 33% completed or, as I think it is, nearly 70% completed, if you look at it, it's virtually completed. And the interior equipment is being installed as we're here today. But it's a testimony to the people that you work with and that you help train for the health and safety and the appreciation in our state and our neighbors, Georgia, for the Savannah River site. And so I'd like to, again, conclude by letting everybody know that I can't wait for my colleagues to visit It's a beautiful community. It's very humbling for me to have the opportunity to represent it, and I can't wait for them to see the actual facility and the percentage of completion. And with that, I yield my time.
I thank the gentleman. The chair wants to again thank the witnesses for their time and commitment and your contributions today. It's been very helpful. I would remind the panelists that we'll leave the record open for 10 days. If anybody has any additional questions, I know I've got a few that I couldn't get to. We'll submit them to you, and if you can just respond to them in a timely manner, I'd appreciate that. And with that, we're adjourned.